Yeah. Good morning. Welcome to Church of the Foothills. My name is Nathan Hill. I am the pastor here. I'm so honored to be your pastor and to welcome you today, whether you're a familiar face or this is your first time worshiping with us. Welcome. Make yourself at home as we gather during this unusual series, maybe not unusual for us, as we explore the music of the Beatles and how it intersects with our faith, our spirituality, and our call to work for peace in our world. So welcome, everyone. It's good to see your faces. It's good to see all of those already online saying hello, including our friend May Parrott, who is recovering from surgery. May, we hope you continue to mend well. But we're here. We're here to be community in this time, to wrestle with Scripture, to ask questions, to learn, to listen, to gather at this table and know that in our tradition, in the way of our church, everyone is welcome at this table wherever you are on your journey with Christ. And as a progressive Christian church, we especially welcome our LGBTQ+ neighbors and friends. Know that you are not going to get turned away at this table. We welcome those of you with questions of faith who are trying to figure life out. Know you are welcome at this table and in this place. In a few moments, an attendant booklet will get passed down. You can fill that out if you'd like to receive information and contact from the church. Get on our email list or just find out ways to connect. You can also go to our website at churchofthefoothills.org. I updated our contact form. It pops up. It's really cool technology. And you can fill that out and we'll get a contact from you. And also, you can give online securely on our website as well if you feel that. But if you're a visitor, don't feel any pressure to give today. And of course, we have exciting activities for our kids today. They'll go back in just a little bit after they help with communion here in a moment. We like to center ourselves. It's been a busy week. There's a lot going on in the world. So we always like to start with just a little bit of silence to gather ourselves, and just let ourselves be in this space for a moment before we begin to sing and worship together. Hear these words. We gather in this space living in fractured times. Have we ever known anything else? As a community, we celebrate the glimpses we see when barriers and walls lay flat and unity seems possible. As we begin in worship, reflecting on the dreams of peace shared by many in this violent world, hear these words from poet Amanda Gorman. We lift our gazes not to what stands between us, but what stands before us. We close the divide because we know to put our futures first, we must first put our differences aside. Let's have a moment of silence before we sing. Amen. We're going to continue in worship by singing a fun Beatles song. The words are in your insert and on the screen. Let's stand together as you are able and lift our voices with the Yellow Submarine. Let's join with our hearts longing for a world where we can live together with compassion and care with all that we need to survive and thrive. Let's be especially on our minds those places in the world, including the Holy Lands, where violence holds sway. And join me in this prayer that comes from a pastor, a global minister from that part, a Palestinian Christian from that part of our planet. God of mercy and compassion, of grace and reconciliation, pour your power upon all your children in the Middle East, Jews, Muslims, and Christians, Palestinians and Israelis. Let hatred be turned into love, fear to trust, despair to hope, oppression to freedom, occupation to liberation, that violent encounters may be replaced by loving embraces, and peace and justice could be experienced by all. Amen. Turn and share a blessing of love and a hello to those around you this morning. As we return to our seats and prepare our hearts for communion, we're going to sing Hallelujah as a short chorus just to refresh ourselves and come with joy to this table. Let's sing together. Didn't pick it up already, our theme today is we're looking at the song by John Lennon called Imagine, and we're thinking about that word peace, something we long for across our world where there is fighting and there are refugees and upheaval and loss, and when we see it on our screens and on our social media feed, our hearts break. Sometimes we don't even know what to do with it all. What I love then about this table is that it was designed, instituted by Jesus among his disciples as a place where even in the midst of their disagreements, of their divisions, of the ways that they didn't understand everything that was going to happen in their lives and in their church, especially after Jesus' death and resurrection, it was intended to be a place where they could come together and remember him, remember who they are, who he called them to be, and share in these gifts of bread and cup as signs of reconciliation to come together and be made whole and be connected in the love and witness of their friend and their teacher, their rabbi, Jesus. So even in this world when we don't always know what to do with the conflict and division we see, whether it's political, whether it is war, whether it's nation versus nation, here at this table, we can bring all of that to Jesus, to our God, our Creator, and come away with these symbols that remind us to never give up on what it means to be one in our Creator, one in the love of God. So we remember Jesus offering his disciples these gifts, bread broken, an act of remembrance of his life shared in the cup of a new covenant of community, of forgiveness, shared together as an act of unity and love. Let's bow for prayer over the bread and cup.
Holy Creator of all persons and things, we thank you for the privilege of prayer. Please help us not only privately share our thoughts, but learn to be quiet and listen for guidance in those talk times too. As we come to this table to accept the bread and the cup, may we pause from the busyness of our lives and really imagine all the good things that could be for all persons here and across all lands. Please guide us as we work together toward fulfilling those initiatives. Gathering here to receive this communion, we're reminded of who we are and whose we are. In knowing that, may our lives, words, deeds, and actions reflect your peace, comfort, justice, and love for all ages throughout your world. Amen. Please welcome at this table. All are welcome.
I've invited a few of our young people to help serve, Chloe, Joseph, Keegan, and Joaquin, as we do this. When we do communion earlier in the service, we have our young people help participate, reminding them that they are part of this table. Come forward, you may receive and eat the bread and the cup as you are ready, as the Spirit guides you.
It's easy if you try. No hell below us, above us only sky. Imagine all the people to kill or die for, and no religion too. Imagine all the people living life in peace. You may say I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will be as one. Imagine no possessions. No need for greed or hunger. A brotherhood of man. Imagine all the people sharing all the world. You may say I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will live as one. Thank
you, Nina. My name is Jim Rosenquist, and I'm generally the guy that asks people to do the reading. But I thought that I should do it. You know, if I ask you guys to do it, I should do it too. So I'm going to do it this week. But if you feel like doing the reading in the future, it's a great thing to do. So anybody that's interested, come and see me, or phone me, or text me, or put it in my Dropbox, or any of those things. We'll set you up. This is Isaiah 11, 1 through 9. There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his root, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear, but by the righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. Righteousness shall be the girdle of his waist, and faithfulness the girdle of his loins. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid. The calf and the lion and the fatling together, and the little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall feed, and their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The suckling child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put his hand in the adder's den. They shall not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Bless this reading.
We invite our young people, as they feel comfortable, to go out and continue their gathering and worship and learning together, and we're going to bless them as they go by singing Sanctuary. Seeing those kids, and school is back, and so I know things are getting busy with all of our young people, and our prayers are with you, and our teachers too. This morning, we think about this word, peace. We just heard it lifted up in the song written by John Lennon called Imagine, which we can have mixed feelings about. It's kind of an interesting song, right? But we hear it too in Scripture, these surprising images woven in our faith, which we'll explore a little bit as well. But I'm curious how you define peace, this idea of peace. Now, I grew up watching movies, loving movies, and so I admit that probably my first definition of what peace was came from a lot of 1980s action movies, including James Bond movies, including some westerns that go further back. And what I learned from these movies is that there's always a current bad guy. There's always a current bad guy that we as a nation or our citizens face. And peace means fighting back against those bad guys, right? Having more weapons and more power and keeping those bad people in check. It could be outlaws on the Wild West. It could be opponents of the war, of whatever, World War I, World War II, the Vietnam War. It could be the Cold War, where the Russians became this our enemy, the Soviet Union. Or it could be after 9/11. Folks, people, a shadowy group from the Middle East. And even occasionally, it could be someone from within who is unhappy with the state of America. And of course, there are all those science fiction movies that it could be aliens, it could be zombies, it could be artificial intelligence. I mean, you know, the movies, they have no end to that. I came across this comedy clip a while ago on one of my favorite talk show hosts, Conan O'Brien, where he speaks to German comedian Flula Borg, who and asked Flula Borg this question about being the bad guy, because let's face it, Germans are sometimes the bad guys in the movies you watch. So let's watch this short little clip now.
Ever get insulted that Germans are always the bad guys in movies?
No. Do you know why?
Why?
I mean, have you Wikipedia'd Germany history before?
Yeah.
we're not Finland, you know. We have some nice cell phones and lots of natural resources.
Yeah. So you think that maybe it's okay?
And actually, I'm a little, I must say, offended about this.
Yeah.
Because when I'm watching bad guy films, and it's like it's a German man.
Yeah.
He doesn't speak with a German accent. Always, he is a British person.
I've noticed that. I've watched a lot of movies where. Tom Cruise did a movie where they played, there was a plot against Hitler, and everyone in it was British, and all the German guys had British accents.
What happened? Yeah. What, did I miss this? Was this a part of history where they're all like, oh, teas and crumpets, and then now, no, we have German accents.
Yeah.
What? Why, Valkyrie? Tell me why.
I don't know. You're asking the wrong guy. I think it's a very good question.
Why, Andy? Tell me why.
Well, I mean, there's something weird about a bunch of Germans speaking English and then having German accents.
I see.
You know
yeah,
what I mean?
There
it
you
is
go.
Sort of like, why, they could have any accent.
Any accent.
Yeah.
It could be anyone.
Australian, any,
hello,
that'd be fun.
Hello, a shrimp on the barbie.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
Okay, now I have a question for you.
Please, I have an answer for you.
Okay. Germans play bad guys in all the other films. Who plays bad guys in Germany?
Germans.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah, we are very self-aware. Who should play bad? We should play the bad guy.
He makes me laugh. He's a character. And yes, maybe, according to history, the sweep of history in the Germany Wikipedia page, Germany should be the bad guys. But I love, too, that he recognizes, too, that part of this journey of peace in some small way is to recognize that we all have to look at ourselves in our work, in our pursuit of peace, whatever that looks like. Our opponents always shift according to media and according to what the world is telling us of who to be afraid of. And sometimes it should be that maybe our biggest threat is within our own borders. But sometimes I think the deeper reality is that it's not just about identifying who the bad guy is. I think, and I dare say, that that's really not the best definition of peace. Yes, peace is aware of those who want to act with evil in the world and bring violence and division about. But peace is deeper than just knowing who our bad guy is and getting rid of them. Peace surely is something else. It's a positive thing. It's about how we live together, how we might imagine life together, how we even dream of how this world and our human family as a whole can share in the gifts of this yellow submarine that we are floating around on. John Lennon, I think, was trying to get at some of this in his famous song after the Beatles broke up. Here's an image of him, if some of you remember this, when he and his love, Yoko, were protesting for peace by not getting out of bed, which I didn't know was a strategy that could work in this world. If so, sign me up. But it was a protest where they were, you know, trying to call attention and long for peace in a time of deep division and conflict. And the song he wrote, which Nina did a beautiful job singing, it does have mixed reactions, right? There are some who would say, you know, it's a nice melody, but it's too simplistic. It's unrealistic. Would a world without all of that stuff even be worth living in? Surely it's just a pipe dream. It's just poetry. It's nonsense. And yet others have found it powerful. This deep longing for a world where everything that divides us melts away, calling us to dream of something else that might be possible, a future where even in our faith traditions, we're not trying to fight and be opposed to each other, but we're trying to figure out how to share in one common vision together. No surprise, this song has changed a lot. That John Lennon, when he would perform it, he would adjust the lyrics based on what was going on and its popularity, but also seeing how the world was shifting and there were different ways to kill each other, different ways that companies were turning profits on mayhem and violence, different ways that neighbors were being divided from each other. When he wrote the song, he says that there were two big inspirations. First, of course, was his beloved bride, Yoko Ono, who was an artist and inspired him through her artistic expressions and profound love. He says that he attended one of her, the first time he met her, he attended an exhibit of hers, and he was immediately smitten. He learned that being an artist through her work means dreaming big of what our world can be. He told a reporter, you know, people said, you're naive, you're dumb, you're stupid. In regards to the song that he wrote, this Imagine. And he says, it might have even hurt us on a personal level to be called names, but what we were doing, you can call it magic, meditation, projection, which business people do, by the way, he says. Even the athletes do it. They pray, they meditate before the game. People project their own future, so what we wanted to do was to say, let's imagine a nice future. Lennon was also inspired, surprisingly, to write this song by a Christian prayer book that Yoko gave him. And as he thumbed through it and read all of these fascinating words and fascinating prayers from our tradition, he used them to imagine a future where it wasn't just about one true religion, but where spiritual barriers fell and prevent enemy from becoming friends and neighbors. All of that wiped away. Can we imagine that? Where Jews, our Jewish siblings, do not have to fear the sting of anti-Semitism. Where Hindu and Sikh neighbors feel welcome at picnics and neighborhood events and in our communities fully as they are. Where Christians aren't turned against other Christians or against Muslim neighbors or vice versa. You know, in our world of pragmatism and military threats and risk assessments, it can seem indeed that John Lennon's song was nonsense, and at the same time, that deep prayer that he offers us, that captivates us, invites us to dream, to imagine what could be. Imagining is also what the prophet Isaiah did in the Old Testament, and the passage we heard. Isaiah was one of the fiercest poets of peace in ancient Israel. And these words he spoke to his community, calling them to be hopeful about the future, but to remind them that God was in their future, that God hadn't given up on them. And his imagery, his poetry, stoked the imaginations of generations to follow. We sing some of his hymns. Some of Isaiah's words are transferred into hymns that we sing on a regular basis in our hymnals. And he would inspire artists from different cultures to paint images of what he imagined. Sometimes we read these verses around Christmas time because in that season with all the twinkly lights and our hopeful feelings, his words call us to look to the future, to the coming of God and God's fullness in our midst. But his words were also supposed to challenge us, to make us a little uncomfortable by challenging us to do that thing that John Lennon and Yoko do of dreaming beyond just knowing who our bad guys are, but knowing what life could be like. Theologians have labeled this image the peaceable kingdom, a reordering of relationships among human beings, but even the animal kingdom. And here's one example of it from a Dutch artist, where the wolf lives with the lamb, the leopard lies down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling are together, and a little child is leading them and playing with them. Where the cow and the bear shall graze, and the young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like a fox. Where even the baby can play over the snake pit without fear. There will be no more harming or destroying on God's holy mountain, for God's fullness will cover the earth like waters of the ocean. Well, this language is so poetic and profound. This vision is bigger than even our faith tradition. I think it's deep-seated in us as humans on some level, for all of creation, to imagine a world where even relationships like predator and prey are reordered, where we can live in peace and not in fear. I mean, I just got back from a camping trip with our scouts. That's why Joseph and Keegan are in uniform. And last night, a skunk visited one of our trash bags. You know, but in some places where we camp out, we have to be aware of bears and things, and we have to be on alert and a little bit afraid of what the bears might do if they come in and we startle them or they startle us or whatever. But this poem says, hey, imagine a life where that wasn't having to happen at all, where we could be in relationship with the animal kingdom, with all of creation, and not trying to extract resources, but to share and to live and to flourish with all that we need. Imagine a world where we don't need to invest in weapons of war anymore. Where you don't have to make plans for the worst to happen. And yes, sometimes our pragmatist folks who I love and are in the room will say, Pastor, that's a beautiful image, but it's nonsense. We have to live in reality. We have to live in a world where sometimes violent things happen. And you know what? I mean, you're right. But John Lennon told that reporter, too. He said, you know, it was nonsense that led scientists and engineers to imagine that we might fly someday, that we might land someone on the moon, that we might cure cancer and illness someday. And when they succeed, we will remember them in their imagination. So why can't we imagine peace, this drastic reordering of life as we know it, this way of living and flourishing together? This song, Imagine Then, could be a Christian ballad, I think. It could be a song that captures that. We may want to alter the lyrics ourselves a little bit because we may like our religion or whatever, but what we want deep down is the same, a world where we don't have to fight anymore. Where refugees are not having to flee their homelands because of upheaval and civil war and violence. Where we don't have to live under a shroud of nuclear war. Can we imagine that? The prophet Isaiah calls us to imagine a future where the rich and the poor can live side by side in peace, where everyone has enough. We're no longer turned against each other. We're even in an election year, we could sit down with a cup of coffee and talk about policy and politics without feeling like we hate each other. A future where all can be at peace. One of the dear people in my life that I just think about often, he passed away, I think, just last year, was a Japanese-American man named Hiro Nakahara. He lived in Dallas. I was his pastor for a short amount of time while I was living in Dallas. A wonderful guy, and my wife and I sat down to talk to him and got to know he and his wife. And the thing about Hiro was, and he was already then, I think, in his 70s, 80s at that point. He passed away in his 90s just recently. He was born in South Korea, what is called now South Korea. But he was born on a Japanese plantation that his father ran for the Japanese government during the period when Japan was occupying South Korea, right before World War II in that era. And that's a fraught time of history for the Korean people. There's still a lot of anger and frustration over everything that happened. Japan and Korea do not always have a good relationship because of that history. Hiro also served his nation in World War II, although he obviously was able to survive to the end of the war and see his people begin to rebuild and find a way to come to the U.S. and then begin dealing with cotton exports and imports and things in Texas and have a good career and have raised three boys and become a part of a church. It was a fascinating story. And then one day he said to me, Nathan, Pastor, this is my dream. My dream is that young people, this younger generations, will throw away all weapons of war and choose peace. And I said, okay, that's an interesting vision. But he said, after the life I've lived and what I've seen and what I went through, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. We don't need it to survive and live and be whole. He inspired me. Because in that moment, I was like, you're not being realistic. We need fighter jets. They're cool, you know, whatever. But he didn't just imagine it. He believed it was a possibility. And he lived it in the way he chose the rest of his life, even being a product of colonization and war himself and having suffered. As we think and contemplate this vision today, I remind you that Isaiah gives it to us too. John Lennon offers it to us too. But it's there deep within us. Yes, there are times that we must be pragmatic, and as a church we are in our work, we have a safety committee that imagines what might happen if something bad unfolds in our midst. How can we care for each other? How can we care for our young people? Our Christian education committee, we have someone coming to do background checks today. So if you want to help with our kids, you have to do a background check because we're going to be pragmatic and safe. And at the same time, we join with the prophet Isaiah by singing from our depths and longing and imagining alongside people like Hero for a world where we don't need weapons anymore, where peace might flow like a river through us. What might that look like here in Orange County? What might it look like at Church of the Foothills? How might we start by treating each other with gentleness and love and our neighbors and being a safe space for all who hunger and thirst for wholeness? How can you work for peace this week? How can we together imagine? Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen.
We invite you to stand as you're able and join us in singing I've Got Peace Like a River. It's number 530 in Chalice Hymnal. Your bulletin might say there's an insert, but that is not true.
Howdy. Peace. we all wish for it, for our disturbed world, for our country, for those in our family who are troubled, for our own minds. Mother Teresa once said, "If we have no peace, it is because we have forgotten that we belong to each other." What I love about this church are the ways that we have not forgotten we belong to each other. We remember, so online we ask for prayers and respond with prayers for those who are sick. We bring food to those in need or for those in mourning. We give school supplies to farm workers' children. We even reach out with fundraising balloon party to help those traumatized by violence in LA. Because we remember we belong to each other, we're building a world of peace instead of conflict. That's stewardship, as far as I'm concerned. Building a peaceful world for everyone to live in, not just ourselves or our neighborhood or even our city, for everyone. I have to tell you that I love this church, and it's because of all of you. You are the community of caring and action I was looking for when I came back to church worship from years of going solo. Over and over, I've been impressed by the ways we find to put our hands and our hearts together for those we barely know, as well as for the health of this planet that we all share. For the young who are being shamed for who they are. For the rights of those on the margin that we may never meet, we still show up. I see us as stewards growing a better world, action by action. I think we're a very generous and loving congregation. We're a people. So I'm going to remind you, here comes the commercial message, that next week is our volleyball, balloon volleyball party. It's after service in Davis Hall. Faith in Action hopes you're going to come and enjoy our very quick run of games and our treats. Remember, your donations are needed and welcome to reach our $2,000 goal. That will give trauma healing training to the staff at Homeboy in Los Angeles. Now, I thought there was going to be a QR code and stuff in an insert in the bulletin. It's not there. So we're going to have to email it to you, and I hope you will open the newsletter this week and read it and respond. But we're also going to be in Davis Hall today and next Sunday, accepting cash or checks. If you write a check, please know you have to make it out to Church of the Foothills. And somewhere at the bottom, just put a note that it's for Homeboy, okay? So it goes to the right place. Look, I'm going to paraphrase John Lennon. He said, "We get by with a little help from our friends. Every dollar donated towards this fun event is going to bring us peace to others and to ourselves." Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks be to God. Thank you for your generosity. And we remind you that we extend this table from this space over to Davis Hall, right across the courtyard, where we have some goodies and coffee to share, where you can speak with Suvan about how you could participate in this this balloon volleyball fundraiser. It's going to be a lot of fun as we raise money to support the work being done to restore those maybe coming out of gang violence, coming out of prison in LA. We extend and that vision of peace with them as well and live into it as a church. Another thing, another ask specifically for today is I've also put a little table over there with some blank cards because as an act of peace, I thought a small act that we could do since school is back in session is to invite you to think about taking a few moments and writing just an encouraging note to go to one of the principals across the street at Foothill High School, okay? They're back in school. They're back in the midst of it. I have a list of the principals and assistant principals. And all you don't have to write an essay, but you won't get graded, but all you have to say is, I'm from Church at the Foothills. We're praying for you. We love you. We appreciate you. If there's anything we can do, let us know. We're thinking about you. Something like that, okay? Just a few sentences. Write out who you want to address it to, which principal. We're going to collect those and go take them over this week and just let them know that they are on our hearts and minds. We want to be good neighbors for those young people and for the staff and faculty there. So you'll see a little table as a way to sow peace. And finally, you'll just see on the back of the bulletin other events coming up. We're looking ahead to our rally day. We're going to have a big picnic after church and really officially kick things off for our fall together. It's great to see each of you, especially guests. Thank you for worshiping with us. If you have any questions about the church, just let me know. See me or see our elder Luella. We'll be out in the courtyard as we prepare to depart. Receive this blessing then, beloved. Go with God's blessing. Empowered and loved closer to wholeness, go and work for peace. Amen. Amen.